Marlene Laruelle is the director of the Central Asia program here at the Institute of European, Russian and Eurasian Studies at the Elliott School of International Affairs at GW, and the organizer of this conference. So you have the last word, so to speak.
Thank you, Sergey. I think my paper will nicely follow Anwar's one, because you really have the inside view from the Kazakh voice and then the analysis of the external expert. I really want to follow on this situation of Kazakhstan as having to manage both the Eurasian integration project and the Central Asian integration ones, and how this is articulated. And when you try to look at the different way it's articulated, you realize that in fact we are sometimes conflating, mixing several different issues that are not in fact related to each other. The first one is the issue of this region having a shared identity. So either Central Asia as having a regional identity, that's one issue to be debated. Then you have the issue of regional institution, that's something else. That's a different issue. You could have regional institutions for countries that do not share a regional identity. And then we have the issue of issue-based cooperation, something that Galinjan explained for counterterrorism, or issue-based cooperation for improving trade. That is also dissociated. You can have issue-based cooperation without having regional institutions, without sharing a regional identity. So you have three levels, in fact, of an analysis, and I think they are important for understanding Kazakhstan perspective. So I will be looking at the Eurasian integration situation, the Central Asian one, and what we have seen emerging, and it has been considered as something anecdotal, but I don't think it is, about the possibility in the not a, a short future that Kazakhstan could suddenly not be a stan anymore, but change its name and try to brand itself outside the regional stan identity. So if we look in terms of regional institution, as Sergey said, all the Central Asian regional institution, that is institution without external actor, they all failed in terms of building a platform where the five countries would work together. The only regional institutions that are really functioning and changing the reality on the ground are the Eurasian one, the one where Russia is the key actor. The CSTO for everything related to strategy, the Eurasian economic community before the custom union, now the custom union, and probably the Eurasian economic union. They are changing the reality on the ground, they are reorienting the economic flow, they are reorienting the strategic cooperation, so they are the only ones that are really changing things on the ground. I will not come back here on the discussion about how the custom union is good or not for a Kazakh economy. That's very complex and it's really depending on the different sectors you look at. What seems to me interesting is that Kazakhstan always linked this Eurasian, Kazakhstan has its own narrative about Eurasia and Eurasianism, and that was part of Kazakhstan's state identity of branding itself as being at the crossroad of Eurasia between Russia, China, the Muslim world, and the West. What has changed now with Russia taking the lead on the Eurasian integration and with the kind of new focus given with the Ukrainian situation is that suddenly it's become difficult for Kazakhstan to use this Eurasia identity as a sign of its multivectoral policy, because it's more and more, this Eurasia narrative is more and more associated only with Russia. And it can be interpreted as something that in fact is creating a disbalance in favor of Russia in Kazakhstan foreign policy, while seen from the Kazakh point of view at the origin, it was something that was, on the contrary, the multivectoral demonstration or ideological arguments of the multivectoral Kazakh policy. And I think now we see a shift in Kazakhstan insisting more and more about having a forum of regional cooperation that would be pan-Asian. And they are not pan-Central Asia, they are pan-Asia, that is really looking toward the continent. And I think that the way they are counterbalancing this Eurasia narrative suddenly being more pro-Russian than what was the original idea. Then if you look at what is going on the ground between Central Asia and Kazakhstan, then you realize that during years we have been telling ourselves that the Central Asian countries, in fact, they couldn't really cooperate because their economies were, in fact, in competition and not in, complementary. But now, 20 years after the collapse of the Soviet Union, you really see very diversified economic patterns, and in fact, they are creating new areas of cooperation. And Kazakhstan is really a critical actor for the development of Central Asia economically. The largest investor in Kyrgyzstan, is the third largest trading partner of Kyrgyzstan, is receiving about 1 million labor migrants from the other Central Asian Republic. It's a key actor in terms of food security for the world region and for Afghanistan. It's a key actor in terms of banking, financial, investment, telecommunication. And if you look on the ground, you can see that, in fact, a lot of small and medium private sector in Kazakhstan would be interested if they had what Farhoud said about better knowledge about things that are going on in the region, maybe a regional chamber of commerce. They would be interested because it's an easy market for Kazakh private investor to invest in Central Asia. It's a market where they would know the norms, they would have less competition, they could test themselves as a private actor. So I think we see kind of ambiguous narrative that sometimes you see Kazakhstan presented itself as the economic leader of Central Asia and really envisioning the region as having great potentiality for Kazakh investment. And at the same time, you still have the narrative about insisting that, well, the link to Central Asia is not only positive, it can also be a dangerous link. It also links to potentially interstate tensions around water, failing states, potential Islamist spillover, and of course the US narrative of linking Central Asia to Afghanistan and Pakistan increased this interpretation of thinking that, oh, the stance, it's less economic opportunities and problems coming from security challenging, because the stance are not only the five post-Soviet, but they are also Afghanistan and Pakistan. So it's changing the color of what means to be inside the stan region. And then we see, so we have this kind of ambiguous view of looking at, from the Kazakh point of looking at Central Asia, both as a chance for regional prosperity and as a risk for destabilization coming from the neighboring country. And then we saw a kind of third way emerging with this idea that Kazakhstan could drop the suffix Stan, and so President Nazarbayev mentioned it openly in February 2014, mentioning Kazakh Yeli as being a potential name. And it was really something that was considered as anecdotal, but I think it's more complex than that. First, the first point I wanted to mention is that it's not new. It's something that arrived regularly in the Kazakh public debate, and even last year, Dariga Nazarbayeva mentioned it, but it was even more a much more stronger argument, saying that Kazakhstan borders Central Asia geographically, but it's not a Central Asian country. We are a Eurasian state. We are not a stand for the media and politicians. Our historical orientations are not towards Saudi Arabia, but toward Norway and countries such as South Korea and Singapore. So we can see the kind of mixing of thinking stance and then connected it to Saudi Arabia, which means that really her vision of stance is kind of crazy, backward, Islamist, the Wahhabi, and so on. But of course, she's also referring to the differences that you have in Russian traditionalism in the 19th century between Middle Asia and Central Asia, Srednya Asia and Central Asia. And in the Middle Asia definition, Kazakhstan is not part of it, because Kazakhstan is part of the steppic world, whereas Middle Asia was used in the Russian terminology as the sedentary part of Central Asia. But what I found really interesting in Nazarbayev's discussion about Kazakh Yeli is that, in fact, he didn't refer to the other Central Asian countries. He referred to Mongolia as an example to follow. And that's really interesting, because what means Mongolia for Kazakhstan? I mean, it's a kind of Asian model that is also between Russia and China, but clearly with the kind of balance geopolitical situation, having a third neighbor policy, welcoming foreign investor, but also looking very much toward East Asia, toward Korea, for example. And you know that Kazakhstan had for a long time this snow leopard symbol, like we are the next kind of Asian tiger or dragons. And then if you look also at Kazakhstan strategy, you see that Malaysia is very often considered as a country that Kazakhstan could follow. because Malaysia is a Muslim country, but it's multi-ethnic, it's multi-religious, it's very modern in terms of economic development, it's looking at innovation, I mean, innovation technologies, it's looking at communication, so all kind of sectors where Kazakhstan tried to brand itself. And something that I found really interesting is that when the Kazakh authorities had to define their halal standards for Islamic food, they choose the Malaysian one. Nothing from Middle East or Turkey, or right, they choose the Malaysian one as an example of something where you have your Islamic identity, but at the same time you are really in a multi-ethnic, multi-religious world, and you are kind of globalizing. So I think that's a way that Kazakhstan, you could find people in Kazakhstan that would consider that it would be good for the country to brand itself through this Mongolia-Malaysia model as something that would kind of give a solution between the dilemma of choosing the Eurasian integration and the Central Asian one. So to conclude, I think that it's really interesting to see that, politically it's difficult for Kazakhstan to know, what if the Eurasian integration has always been given the preference institutionally. At the same time, it's create also difficulties for Kazakhstan to be sure its room of maneuver is maintained in the current context and in relationship to Russia. Even it's clearly seen from Astana, it's largely easier to discuss with Moscow than it is to discuss with Tashkent. And I think we have to be clear on that. I mean, the level of cooperation is just 100 times more developed with Russia, and where Kazakhstan considers itself as being an equal partner in the discussion, while the relationship with Tashkent is difficult. Economically, I think you can have arguments on both sides, in favor of Eurasian integration, but also in favor of having Kazakhstan being more involved in Central Asian economic development. And then you have this kind of Mongolia-style Kazakhieli third path, like looking, trying to develop a specific way of development that would be very kind of Asia-Pacific, looking, that would manage economic modernity and cultural globalization. And of course, one of the elements which is not discussed at all in this Kazakhieli narrative is the place of Islam. And the fact that the younger generation in Kazakhstan, and especially in rural region, can be more interested by Islam than the previous generation, that you also have this massive labor migration from the other Central Asian country to Kazakhstan, and therefore, in a sense, because of migration and because of the place of Islam, you have a growing Central Asianization potentially of Kazakhstan in terms of its social fabric. So to conclude, I think, in fact, the country, in a sense, play on the three levels I mentioned. I think in terms of institution, clearly Eurasian integration will be given priority because they are functional, for good, for bad, but they are functional, and clearly the relationship with Russia will be privileged, even if things can slow down depending on how this Eurasian Economic Union will be functional or not. In terms of issue-based cooperation, and I think that's clearly something that Anu mentioned, clearly Kazakhstan gave priority now to Central Asia, and I agree that it's the Eurasian integration is also pushing Kazakhstan to look more to Central Asia and to try to be more involved, but maybe not in the sense of creating regional institution with the other Central Asian country, because it failed historically, but just working on issue-based cooperation, something that would be really much more pragmatic and probably much more functional. And in terms of branding the state identity of the country, I think that this narrative, this Kazakhieli narrative, I mean, becoming a reality or not, of course, Kazakhstan can continue to brand itself without changing its name, but this idea that the country has a specific path of development that is not the Russian one, neither the Central Asian one, but which is something looking toward East Asia, Southeast Asia, is something that the country will be playing on very much in the near future, because it's really going with both its economic development, but also with a lot of kind of globalized way of branding itself for the younger generation in Kazakhstan, which is much more globalized than probably many of the other younger generation in Central Asia. Now we stop here.
Yeah.